Hey folks, Joseph A. Sabora here. Halloween is tomorrow, so I'm about to review one of my personal favorites of mine that came out in 1990 that happens to be based on the popular 80s horror anthology series called Tales from the Dark Side, the movie. That's right, which happens to be the same team behind Creepshow 1 and 2, which, surprisingly enough, originally this was going to be the third installment of the Creepshow series. But unfortunately, due to budget restraint and all this other stuff that's been happening, they decided to redub this as simply Tales from the Dark Side, the movie. According to Tom Savini, the master behind all the special effects. And he's been acting on every single film he's been in. Yeah, including Maniac and all these other films. There was a newspaper article or some of those entertainment stuff. I actually went online and found out about this, that they were actually going to start it out with Tales from the Dark Side being just a standalone movie as we speak, and Creepshow 3 was going to come out as well back in the 80s. Unfortunately, that never did happen. So Tales from the Dark Side, the movie, was already simply a standalone film that was actually supposedly the real Creepshow 3. While Creepshow 3 winds up out of the dust until all of a sudden it was done sometime in 2006. Wasn't released until 2007 after that. So that was like, wow. We waited a long time to get the third installment of Creepshow. Yeah, hard to believe. Although I haven't seen the third installment yet, but I'll take my chances on that one. Yeah, later on. Because I know I saw the first two and they were classics. Anyway, I remember this movie came out on my birthday. Just turned 5 at the time, and interesting enough, it actually became a modest box office success, which apparently was going up against other films like Pretty Woman and all that, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. So I figured it was going to make some money, by the time it was released. And I think I actually went to see the film after it came out. In fact, I probably saw it as a double feature with some other film. I think I saw this with the one with Lou Diamond Phillips called The First Power. That's right, there were two horror films I saw. So I might have saw Tales from the Dark Side of the movie with The First Power. Anyway, we soon later bought the VHS tape from Woodworth's, which is no longer there anymore, but it was an old store. Used to be located here in Glenmore. And we watched it, and I never got tired of it. Yeah, it was fun, scary, and quite a lot darker than the original series, surprisingly enough. Because it had a lot of blood into this. It has a lot of blood in the film. A lot of creepy scenes that went into it. It's like, it's far different from what the series had really suggested. And what's interesting enough, it actually, surprisingly enough, and what's interesting is that they even brought in some of the same actors, or singer for that matter, that actually went on to do special guest appearances on the series as well, such as Deborah Harry, from Blondie, the rock singer who later became an actress later on. And she's very good in those movies that she's been in. And especially in this film, though, she was really awesome. Playing the witch, about to cook Matthew Lawrence's character inside the house, sort of in the tradition of Hansel and Gretel. Wow, he's just reading all three stories that's from the film. Yeah. Which we're going to get right to it. Yeah. And they also have Christian Slater in the movie, too. Also was on Tales from the Dark Side. I think William Hickley actually appeared in an episode before. Yeah, probably did, actually. Well, either way. It was amazing. And also the fact that all three of these stories were actually based on the novels by, get this, Stephen King, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, Michael McDowell, who's the author behind Beetlejuice. Yeah, he also did the adaptation of a Sir Arthur Conan Doyle story. And simply, George A. Romero, who's also the executive producer behind the series as we speak, and he's also the master behind Night of the Living Dead. Interesting. Let's get right to the film. The movie stars Deborah Harry with Matthew Lawrence, Steve Buscemi, Christian Slater, Julianne Moore, William Hickley, Alex Drumlin, David Johansen, Dolores Sutton, Mark Margolis, James Wanmar, and Ray Don Chong. And it's directed by John Harrison, who also happens to do the score on the third story, and also had directed some episodes of Tales from the Dark Side as well. Yeah. So let's get right to this awesome movie. The movie begins when a suburban housewife, who turns out to be a modern-day witch named Betty, who's played by Deborah Harry, is planning a surprise dinner party, but the main course turned out to be a young boy named Timmy, who's played by Matthew Lawrence. Already being captured and chained up in her pantry, being planned to be stuffed and roast, Timmy decided to tell her three horror stories from the book that she gave him called Tales from the Dark Side. So in the first segment, which is based on an Arthur Conan Doyle short story called Lot 249, which Michael McDowell actually adapted, a graduate student named Bellingham, who's played by Steve Buscemi, has been treated on two classmates, Susan and Lee, both played by Julianne Moore and Robert Sedgwick, who actually framed them for theft to ruin his chances of winning a scholarship that they were competing against with. So as a result, Bellingham decided to create a revenge by reanimated a mummy and used it to murder both of them. So somehow, Susan's brother Anthony, who's played by Christian Slater, had kidnapped Bellingham and births of a child mint and the mummy, and also planning on killing Bellingham himself. But unfortunately, he can't commit real murder. So his heart softens to serve him up poorly, which of course gives away the twist ending, which I'm not going to spoil too much of it. That's pretty much how it went. On the second segment, it's called Cat from Hell, which George A. Romero had adapted a Stephen King short story of the same name, which seems more like a darker version of The Black Cat, which already had both films already, the original and the remake. Anyway, a sickly, wealthy wheelchair brown old man named Drogan, who's played by William Hickley, had hired a hitman named Halston, who's played by David Johansen, who happens to be a singer of Buster Poindexter, and of course an actor best known for his roles in Scrooge and Car 54 Where Are You, the adaptation of a popular TV series from the 60s that's done in the 90s, decided to kill what seems to be a black cat, but it wasn't any ordinary black cat. This was a killer one. A black cat from hell. So all this time, Drogan had believed that he is mysteriously evil, He actually explains that there were three other occupants in his house before the catter arrived. His sister Amanda was played by Dolores Sutton. Her friend Carolyn was played by Alice Drummond. Yep, she's also in an episode of Tales from the Dark Side. It was the episode where, you know, she was about to go on a diet, and suddenly she makes contact on all the fruits and vegetables. Yeah, hard to believe. That was actually a creepy episode. And the family butler named Richard Gage, who was played by Mark Margolis. Anyway, once they all got killed, he would become the next victim, in which Drogans from a cubicle company had killed 5,000 cats while testing a new drug, and he is convinced that this black cat is here to commit cosmic revenge. However, Halston didn't believe in the story, but is more willing to eliminate the cat since Drogan is actually offering $100,000. Well, once he tries to do that, in order for the deed to be done, unfortunately, the cat is so horrifyingly crazy that he goes around killing Halston one by one. Yeah. Especially when he tries to go, and this is one of the darkest scenes in this movie. Probably enough for me to go race in the room, you know, to hide. But there was a scene where the cat actually went inside his mouth. Yeah, climbing down into his throat, and that was where, you know, that's how messed up that whole scene was. Yeah, he killed him all the way once he went inside. And then when the black cat finally came out of his mouth, he actually scares Drogan away until suddenly Drogan dies of a heart attack. Yeah, it was really creepy. And then finally, the final segment is called Lover's Bow, which is written by Michael McDowell. Happens to be based on a Japanese folklore known as Yugi Onna, or surprisingly, the Koan stories of studies of strange things. Anyway, an artist named Preston, who's played by James Remar, has witnessed a gruesome murder that's committed by a gargoyle. The monster had agreed to spare Preston's life by giving him a promise he'll never keep, by never to speak to anyone or about what he saw or heard, or even describe the appearance of the gargoyle itself. Not to anyone whatsoever. The monster had vanished and actually scratched his chest, you know, leaving him very traumatized and confused, but bound by his oath to never talk about the incident. So after that night, Preston's life takes many turns for the better, as he finally meets a beautiful woman named Carola, who's played by Ray Don Chon. And they actually fall in love and winds up having two children. Preston, however, was struggling his art career and become wildly successful, and his life seems very promising, but he's been tormented by the memories of the encounter with the gargoyle itself, and his vile silence weighs on him until suddenly, one night, he actually broke a promise and told Carola about the monster. Not only that, he even showed her statue that he sculpted on, which all of a sudden, you're not going to believe this, she actually appears very upset until suddenly she transforms into the same gargoyle as he saw before. So that it turns out all this time, it was her that became the gargoyle. So he knew he was lying all this time. He even turns the two children into the gargoyles as well. And it kills Preston, and finally, you know, the gargoyle with the two children are already down on the ledge. It was really messed up, but yet, that's what happens when you break a promise. And by the end of the film, Timmy suddenly saves the best story for last, once he hasn't told her the really best part of them all. which happens to include, as we speak, a happy ending. And yes, this is where he goes out of control once Betty winds up narrating his own actions by throwing some marbles on the floor. Betty, of course, winds up slipping and fell into the butcher's block. A lot of sharp knives. You know, already been impaling herself, and then suddenly Timmy releases himself and pushes her into her own oven. And then the movie finally ends with Timmy winds up helping himself a cookie and breaks the fourth wall with this one awesome line at the end. Don't you just love happy endings? And the movie ends. Oh man, and it was awesome. This movie. It was dark, creepy, scary, hilarious, and just plain fun. You just never get tired of this movie. You just watch it over and over and over again. In fact, it plays exactly like the TV series, or even, for that matter, Creepshow, but it's far different. It's a lot darker than any other episode we've seen. I mean, some of them had some cheesy dialogue and all this other crap that they put in, but this one had everything. And it actually works, you know, having to add a modern-day Hansel and Gretel-type story to introduce from the beginning, all the way from the middle till the end, because now you get to see how the whole thing began. Well, one of my personal favorites out of all the segments they use in the film happens to be The Cat from Hell. No doubt about it, because that film really creeped me out a lot. Even more than Lot 249 and Lover's Bell. Which, yes, those were creepy too, but Cat from Hell was far the creepiest of all. Because let's face it, this black cat is as scary as any other black cat out there. And surprisingly enough, I have a black cat, and her name is Kiki. And happens to be a cute black cat who actually meows like a kitten. But he goes around, you know, having fun and, you know, play around. And even sometimes gets along with the two dogs we have. So, it's cool. And I really love it. But now I know why black cats are considered to be superstition. Because some black cats, like the cat here, can be very scary. It's like, you know, you just can't handle them. Especially when they're loud. But not me, because I love cats. So I'll definitely enjoy dealing with a black cat, as long as it's not one of those creepy ones. Like, especially ones that have rabies or something. Yeah. So watch out. This one really started killing every victim out there, like trying to go straight to, like, especially the scene where they go straight to their mouths. I mean, that was messed up. That it was actually done with prosthetics and all that makeup, and I think they used some clay they probably used some clay and masks just for the cat to go inside the mouth and then come right out straight as the blood starts to shoot up. Yeah. Very creepy the way this was done. And yeah, there were some problems with some scenes that went into it, but other than that though, it's fun. I enjoyed it. Definitely worth recommending, especially if you love Creepshow and the TV series. This is a treat. So anyway, I give Tales from the Dark Side the movie 5 stars. I'm Joseph A. Saburo, and I'll see you later. Bye.